Because I think the answer is yes. Before we do, I want to just talk a little bit about how this compares to Series A stock held in a privately held company. This is typically how companies in most of the Western world funded themselves for the last 20, 30 years. You would sell a stock, usually known as Series A, to early investors, angel investors or VCs, and they would buy that stock. Now the difference is that tokens are tradable any time of the day. So they're not even like stocks. When the stock market shuts down and then opens up again, you know, after the weekdays, and it closes at a certain time each day and opens at a certain time the next day. Tokens are actually tradable 24/7. They're typically listed within hours or days of the initial token offering. So this is also very different than stock. Stock might, most of the time, the vast majority of companies never ever get to a point where they have a listed stock. Less than 1% of all the companies that have stock ever get a listed stock. It's substantially less than 1%. So this is another major change. Token holders have very limited governance. So companies like this because they say, well, I don't want the shareholders telling me what to do. I know better about what needs to happen. And so they like it because they're not getting a board that comes in with the shareholders and basically says this is what you need to do. So they like that. And sales are global events. So people participate all over the world. This means that you actually raise money in these things that is not just from your region or your country, but from all over the world, particularly if you do a good job of marketing. And millions of dollars can be raised in seconds. This is very difficult to do in the stock market. So these are some really significant changes. These are going to be very important to pay attention to. Now, if we look at the total token market cap over the last 2 years, so this is a graph of all coins, all tokens, and what's happened over the last 2 years. What you can see is over here, not much was going on until about April of this year, and then the price went way up, came back down to kind of where it is today. Now, many people would say, well, that was the bubble popped, and basically now this has come out. Other people will say, well, no, there's more bubble to happen. There's a lot more to come. But this is actually not a very good way of analyzing this data. If you look at the data based on price, you actually will mislead yourself in understanding what's going on. The bubble actually happened in April through May and into June. Here's the bubble. This is looking at the exact same data, but using a different way of actually mapping the data. And this, now we're looking at the data not based on dollar value increase or decrease, but based on the exponent of growth. Now, for those of you who aren't mathletes, what exponent of growth means is that we are looking at this based on the percentage of growth, it's the way to think of it, period over period. Notice that the line was relatively straight for a very long period of time. In fact, if we went back two more years on this graph, that line would stay flat almost for 2 years. This is what you would expect to see in a healthy business that's growing and expanding and starting to get a following, like Facebook or any of the other businesses that have happened out there. At this point right here, this line is what should have been going on. This is what happened right here. This happened in May. That was when the rate of growth jumped. It then flattened out again and jumped again here and has now come partway back down to meeting this line. What that means is this is likely, there is a bubble. This one burst here, came back down. This one here has still not burst. Now, whether or not it ever will or not, it might not. but there's a good chance that that actually represents a meaningful change that will at some point see a market correction. But forget this top line. Look at this line here. The trend is still the same, regardless of whether you think there's a bubble or not, regardless of whether there's an adjustment or not, that line is still going up, and both lines are going up at the same trajectory, which means something between the top line and the bottom line is real. That's real, and that's actually going up. So, the big question is this the future? What's really happening here? Well, let's point out that some things are not as they appear. So far, everything I've talked about sounds like amazing. We've got to get in on this thing. This is going to be the next big deal. Anybody who tries it wins, et cetera, et cetera. Well, not so much. Only 48% of the ICOs that were attempted in 2017 were successful. The definition of successful here is they raised more than $100,000. Which means if they didn't, they probably cost more to do than it actually produced in benefit. So of the people that tried to do an ICO in 2017, 52% failed. By the way, that was double over the prior year. So the trend is getting worse. 25% of all that money that was raised was for 2% of the projects. So 2% of the projects raised all that big number of the 5.8 billion. That was done by 2% of the projects. The majority of the projects raised fewer than $1 million, which is a really significant thing. The cost and effort to do an ICO is also increasing. So the cost to raise $500 million or more in an ICO is now at least $500,000, which means if you don't have $500,000, it's highly unlikely you will raise $5 million or more. To raise $20 million or more takes $3 to $4 million, or 15% of your total proceeds. To raise $50 or more takes $10 million, or 20% of your total proceeds, and these numbers are going up. Yes?
How do you calculate the amount of money required to raise in order to achieve?
So this is information that I got from the people in the space who basically do this as advisory firms, in terms of what it's actually costing for people to raise these funds. So analyst firms basically do this. Those numbers, by the way, are about double this year. In 2017, are about double over 2016. So the point is, this is not the magic plan. This is not the magic plan. But notice something really important. The lower amount you try to get, the cheaper it gets. And that is a real thing. So it's not that you can't raise a successful ICO for, say, you know, a little bit of effort and time. It can be done. But the lower amount that you raise, that you have to invest in the raise, the lower amount you should have as your goal. It also means that the current trend towards big splash raises, where you put up a number at a clock on your website, it counts down to a particular date, and everybody throws in their money, that's becoming less and less and less the future trend. The future trend will be multiple raises over multiple releases, just because it's becoming too costly to distinguish yourself from all the noise of all the bad ICOs out there, and to get yourself recognized as having a good one. It's becoming harder and harder, and it takes more and more time, community building, and cost to kind of distinguish yourself as real. So, what is real? Well, there's probably a bubble. That bubble will pop in the next few years. I've shown you what that looks like. Much like the internet bubble that existed back in the end of the 90s, there's probably a bubble here too. But the long-term economics behind these coins are very significant and are likely to have a bigger impact than the coins themselves. We're going to take a look at that in just a minute. The coins are really a symptom of something else that is going on. The economics of tokens will probably change how we think of business. Today we think of business in terms of I need money, I start a business, I help build it up, I get some investors maybe, some family members, some friends, they help out, sweat labor, or maybe they give me a little money, I take some of my own money, I build my business. That kind of model is probably going to start to change. I'll show you that in a minute. And global funding has powerful potential for the Philippines. So for the Philippines and other developing nations, this is a really powerful idea because bringing money from outsiders into this country, even $100,000 here would be an amazing amount of money to start a business with. That would be absolutely astounding amount of money to start a business here in the Philippines. So let's step back for a second and ask ourselves, is there something more fundamental going on? I want to suggest to you that there is, and that this is part of the base of it. So we are in a world, and have been for some time, where innovation is increasing. What this means is that the pace at which new things come along is becoming more and more and more rapid. And if you're in an environment where new things are happening more and more frequently, what happens is that historic models of funding need to change. So if you can take 10 years to build up a business and get it successful before you have an exit event by selling your stock or taking it public, well, not a big deal. But if your business might not even last 10 years before the next disruptive change changes your business model, even if you survive, it changes your business model. This becomes more and more and more difficult to actually have something you can take through public markets. This is one of the reasons why the number of companies going public worldwide has been declining as a percentage of startups for the last two decades, and will continue to decline. The next problem is the complexity is increasing. So not only are we creating more things that we're creating are becoming more complex, which means that distinguishing between one product and another product is becoming more difficult. It's easier for people to hype things, to pretend that they're what they aren't, to make claims about them that are difficult to verify. And this also creates an environment where it becomes more and more and more difficult to fund businesses in traditional ways. Finally, choice is increasing. And this is probably the most significant change of all. The social science on this is really amazing. If I was to give each of you in this room three choices for a product or a service that was similar, the vast majority of you would actually be able to pick one. In fact, better than 90% of you would pick one. Whether you knew anything about the product or not, you would be able to, within a few minutes, say, I'll pick that one. But if I increase the number of choices to 5 instead of 3, only 70% of you would actually pick one. 30% would be frozen by the choices. If I increase that number to 7, just 2 more, it drops to 30% of you would actually make a choice. If given 7 different choices of things, most people won't actually make a choice. This causes people to freeze. What all of this means is we are moving into a world that works very differently than the world that has worked through most of the industrial era. Through the industrial era, we invested in centralized businesses to compete with the centralized things. This is the huge opportunity for the Philippines. You have you don't have the legacy infrastructure, the legacy corporations, and the legacy things that you have to tear down to replace with this. It's the same thing that happened in the cell phone industry that we're now talking about happening. What's happening here is that three technologies are emerging together. We have never seen this occur in history of the human race. AI, IoT, and blockchain. And all of those things are getting connected on an internet where they all start communicating together and they start transferring value together. And this all is happening in automated fashion all at the same time. This mechanism needs a new type of economy. It needs a new type of economic infrastructure for it to work. And it is that which is driving what's going on in all these ICOs, what's going on in blockchain. It is that that's really driving this thing. We don't have the time for payment to take a week to go from the United States to the Philippines. We need to have that happen in 10 minutes. We don't have the time for us to go through governmental approval processes to establish some new entity or business. We need that to happen in a few days. The reason is the opportunity cost of not being able to move now is increasing and increasing and increasing as the pace of change increases and we move more into a global world. Okay, so how does the blockchain fit into all this? What's real and what's hype? So for those of you who don't know much about the blockchain, let me give you a kind of an idea of what it is. And for those of you who are technical and think about the blockchain technically, I want to kind of reframe you to think about it in another way. It's not that it's not interesting to think about it technically. It's very interesting to me when I was originally involved with the internet and the creation of TCP/IP stacks to think about that technically. It's a lot of fun. But all the things I've known about how TCP/IP stacks work really isn't anything that anybody uses on the internet today, and nobody gives a damn about it. So it wasn't terribly important. So what is the blockchain? Well, first, it is a distributed ledger. Now, this is a very important thing. Think of this as a public accounting of something. So today, the money that you have in your bank, you know what your bank account is, but you just know it. So if you're working with somebody else, they can't tell what it is. But the idea of you being able to work in a world where that becomes transparent has some pretty profound implications if you're a business. And having public information about accounting records is actually quite a massive change that can occur in the world. It means it's very easy for governments to police things like tax. It means it's very easy for people that need to trade together to validate that others have the money they claim to have. It's very easy to do a lot of things that's very difficult to do in today's world, just by having a public record. The second is a method of value exchange. So this is also very important. Today, to do any kind of value exchange, we typically have to go through an intermediary where we have to be physically present. I have to give you some pesos because I'm standing in front of you. I have to send somebody on a motorcycle to give you some pesos. I have to be physically present. Or I have to go through a bank, a credit card company, or some intermediary who will handle the exchange of value on my behalf. That's over. The blockchain has ended that forever. There's no telling how deep that's going to change things. Because now anybody can send money anywhere to some other place without the need for anyone else to be involved. It is also a shared database. A shared database of records. Records like who owns that house? Who owns that car? Who are you? What do you know? What certificates do you have? How do I know? All sorts of things that are important for us to know to build up trust in an environment are now in a shared now be placed in a shared database. And these are really significant things. Most of the regulatory bodies in the Philippines or any other government work on reconciling the accounting system with the actual monetary value with the public record. That's what most government agencies do. That's what your tax authority does. That's what most of the compliance organizations do. That's what most governmental agencies do. So here's a much better way of looking at it. In the existing world today, who the legal owner is, the accounting records about something, the financial payment for something, and reality all have to be reconciled with one another. And look at how many arrows there are up on that. A lot of arrows there, right? And there's a lot of lines. That is a tremendous amount of friction. That is a tremendous amount of work. And it's a tremendous opportunity for error. And it is what almost all of us just assume has to happen. When you go into a store here, and there's a person who's at the cash register, and there's somebody else that checks what the person's doing, that's because of that problem. It's because there's no way to make sure that those things are kept together. The opportunity to steal, the opportunity to lie, the opportunity to commit fraud, the opportunity to not pay your taxes, the opportunity to do all sorts of things in the world, the opportunity for a bank to lie, to cheat, to steal, the opportunity for a company to lie, to cheat, to steal, all are made possible because those things are disconnected. When you connect those things together, which is what the blockchain does, it puts all of these into one transaction that occurs atomically or doesn't occur. That is unbelievably revolutionary because it means that the state that those three things says about something can never be out of sync. This means the accounting record that talks about what something is accounted for, how it should be accounted, matches the legal ownership records, and that matches the financial payment. This is unheard of. This has never, ever been possible in all of history, and it means most regulatory bodies can now go away. It means that auditors or companies can now largely be eliminated. It means that most regulations that countries have put in place to protect people from people who cheat about those things aren't needed. This is very, very fundamental. This is a non-trivial change. So let's look at this another way of what this implies. In the 1950s, for those of you in the back of the room with bad eyesight, I'll read this for you, sorry about the size of the print. In the 1950s, we had manufacturing-based businesses, and those businesses were valued economically. Their value was profit times a discount for risk times 5 to 7 years. That's what the value of a manufacturing business is. Most people in the Philippines and most businesses in the Philippines, their value today is using that formula, which was the 1950s formula for measuring a manufacturing business in the United States or Western Europe. In 1985, a new business model started to emerge, and that was software businesses. Their business model was based on EBITDA, not profit. I know it says profit up there, it's an error. Times a discount for risk times 7 years. EBITDA, if you don't know what that is, it's profit less taxes, interest, depreciation, and amortization. So this means a whole bunch of other things come out and the profit number goes up. This is really the operating level of the business from a cash flow point of view. In 2000, we saw the emergence of SaaS businesses. This is software as a service. Software as a service are things like Salesforce.com, software as a service was valued by recurring revenue times growth rate times a multiple, typically 3. This is a much higher value business. Then we moved to social businesses like Facebook. They were measured by users times growth rate times value of each user. So if I got 1 million users and I'm growing at 20% a year and each user can generate $20 a year in advertising revenue, then I just take the 1 million I pay, anyone moving there makes $100,000 a year. We got people standing in line to come to Scott Island, right? But at the very beginning, we don't have much value in it at all. But what happens if I sell pieces of Scott Island early for low amounts of money? Well, if you believe in Scott Island and I can sell it to you for really cheap here, then the value of getting in early is really high. But once Scott Island has got all those hotels and everything on it, the value of joining later is not so high in terms of buying property because you're going to have to pay the really high inflated prices. It's like buying land now in, the IT park or something. But when that was the airport, you could buy that land cheap. Okay, so this is what tokens are doing. They incentivize people by saying, if you get in now, this is going to be worth a lot more later, and it will cost a lot more to join later, so it's better to get in now. But by getting in now, you solve this problem here, where the reason people are getting in is because of what the future will be, not for what it is now. And this is what people are trying to do with ICOs. This is what the better designed tokens do. This is why Bitcoin has seen the rise of value that Bitcoin has had. So network-based business models are really different in this token space. So they're frequently different. They're typically non-profit. What's that about? Why is that? Well, the reason they're non-profit is because you don't want to be selling a token and then saying, oh, by the way, if you buy my token, I'm going to get filthy rich. Me and my investors are going to get a lot of money. You'll find a lot of people don't like that story so much. So that's not a very successful mechanism. If you look at the tokens that have raised the most money, the vast majority of them are all nonprofit foundations. Why is that? Because there isn't two ways of people making money, and so people aren't suspicious about how money is being made. Money is made by appreciation in the token, not stock or profit. So there's no profit mechanism. There's no ability to distribute money via stock. It'll be worth a bunch of money later on. Many of these organizations basically raise their money for all of the ongoing network and support costs in a one-time event. This is probably not a good idea, by the way. It's becoming less and less common, but it's still a prevailing thing. Many will never generate a dollar of revenue. What? I have a business that doesn't actually generate revenue? I mean, I don't charge people anything? No. Many never generate a bit of revenue. Bitcoin Foundation does not make any money from Bitcoin. The Ethereum Foundation does not make any money from Ether. They don't make any money. Tokens are used as an incentive for early adopters. Join now, get in early, it's going to be a great place to move later, but you get in now, you have a hedge against the future. And many of these are open source projects with absolutely no protection on their technology or IP. You might wonder why. Well, if you're a nonprofit organization, then you don't really care if somebody basically takes the technology and continues developing it. People don't care if they own Bitcoin, whether more people take Bitcoin and do stuff with it, because it only increases the brand of Bitcoin, and it only makes Bitcoin more valuable. So, not a problem. I don't care. The value comes from the token. It doesn't come from a standard business model. So these are very different business models. Now, I want to show you what I think is the most underappreciated and most important thing about these business models. Now, I'm going to say some things and I'm going to come across to be crazy. I'm not crazy. There is some very, very good literature out there supporting this. In a classic equity-based business model, where you have stock in a company that people own called shareholders, the laws of every nation say that if you have a company that has shareholders, that if you work for that company, your fiduciary responsibility as an officer is to run the company for the benefit of who? Shareholders. So I want you to think about this. If you can screw the customer out of another 10 cents, what are you supposed to do? Screw the customer out of another 10 cents. Why? Because you are doing it to increase the profit, which increases the value of the shareholders. If you can find a way to pay employees less money, what are you supposed to do? Pay them less money. You are required by the law. You can, as an officer, be drug in front of the court in every major nation on this planet right now, and you can be sued. In fact, after the 2008-2009 financial crisis, the laws regarding this became even more aggressive. Even more aggressive. The person who's at the bottom of the totem pole here is the customer. So rape the customer for as much money as you can get out of the customer's pocket to put it into the company. Then give the employees the least you can possibly give them to give as much to the shareholders. This is the model of a shareholder-driven company, not as it was originally envisioned hundreds of years ago, but as we have built it as a result of protecting major industrial investors. The laws that are out there are designed to protect the wealthy, not because they want to keep you poor, but because they want to keep the wealthy rich. And the wealthy have been in charge of writing the rules. So guess what you do when you're in charge? You write rules that are to your benefit. So this is kind of what happens. This is not what happens with good token models. This is what happens with good token models. In good token models, you actually raise your money from your customers. The customer actually funds the business. And because you're open source, because you are nonprofit, the customer has the right to fire employees. They can do it two ways. One is called forking. So they fork, and they set up something new. I don't like what you're doing, I don't like where you're going, I think this ought to be done differently. A bunch of customers get together and say, we're going to do it this other way, and they fork the code. That's actually a good thing, because it puts the customer in charge. And the employees are dedicated to what? Making sure the customer gets value. Why? Because the customer will fire them if they don't. Now, this is a very different motive. So it's not that I want to get as much money out of the employee's pocket. That's not what the customer cares about. So take Bitcoin. Who are the employees of Bitcoin? They're the miners. We have a miner in the room. I think he might testify to the fact that miners make money. Okay? Good money. You know? You can buy Lamborghinis with the money that miners make. Okay? They're the employees. Customers, when they don't like what the employees, what the miners are doing, what do? Segwit. They try to fork the code. Right? And it's an economy that we are focusing on making things that people think of as being impossible, possible. So what are those things? So in the Sweetbridge economy, we use crypto economics and blockchain to enable payments, loans, funding of businesses, both startup and major, and liquid supply chains. And we do this all through two very simple token designs that are amazingly elegant, and as a result produce all the side effects. So the first, global payments in minutes. This is actually quite easy to understand. You can make your computer or your cell phone becomes your wallet. It stores both fiat and cryptocurrency. You send any money anywhere you want, anywhere in the world, and you can do it in minutes. Your phone replaces your credit card, so you don't use your credit card anymore with merchants that accept it. You basically just bring your phone and you take your QRC code from your phone and let the merchant take a picture of it, or you use the near-field communication on your phone to actually make the purchase. This requires no banks, no banking infrastructure, and no credit cards, which means the merchant doesn't pay a bank a fee for the transaction, you don't pay the bank a fee for the transaction, nor does the merchant get 2 to 3% of the value, or even worse, taken off the money they get when they use a credit card. So no difference in credit card or cash. Loans and minutes. This is probably the most revolutionary thing we'll talk about. This is the future of loans. Low to 0% interest. Yes, I did mean 0% interest. So the people that you borrow money from today that you pay 20%
input,
that will go away. Terms set by you. This is when these are low asset backed. If asset backed lending, like on your house, you want a balloon payment 5 years from now, fine. You want an interest only loan, fine. You want a 25-year, you know, straight line appreciation loan, fine. You set the terms. One loan for all your needs. You don't have a loan for your credit card, one for your motorbike or car, one for your house, one for your inventory, one for your factory, one for your truck. You just have one. And new loans take as little as 1 minute, depending on the asset class as a whole. So you can literally do it in 1 minute on your cell phone without a credit check, all automatic. Fund to grow your business. So this is a mechanism that allows us to actually fund startups. We can fund startups and existing businesses, providing them with equity funding to grow their business, but without any need to get equity. They do not need to do an ICO, and there's no debt. The way this works is the business gives up a percentage of their future revenue, and they just sell a portion of their revenue. And they get an international sales and support organization to sell and support their product worldwide. So all of this from one platform. The next is liquid supply chains. What this does is it increases the amount of cash on your balance sheet. If you don't know what a balance sheet is, it's in essence the place where you keep track of the amount of money you've made, the assets that you have, the cash you have, the liabilities you have, and as a result, the remaining capital balance, which is the business value of your business. Decreases working capital requirements to zero. This means that this is the difference between when people pay you as customers and when you pay your suppliers as customers and the amount of money tied up in your inventory. That all becomes zero. In typical business, that would actually be maybe 30, 60, 90 days of whatever your sales are. Improved profit. Every organization we've modeled this with so far, we improve the profit margin by at least 2%. If you're a really big corporation, that would be transformational. And increased transparency in your supply chain. They can almost be impossible for there to be any fraud in the supply chain. whether it's food or whether it's drugs, whether it's, doesn't matter really what it is. Now, all of these things, okay, that was just what we do, that's what we do. All of this is created by an economic system that uses two tokens. So this is going back to the points we made before about token design and economics are really the key. So we do this through two tokens. One is a token that is stable and is pegged to fiat of your choice. So you can get it in USD, you can get it in Philippine peso, euro, Japanese yen, whatever you want. 100% of Bridgecoin is asset backed. In fact, it's backed by more assets than the value of the coin. This is unlike fiat currency, which is backed by the economy that prints the currency. You can say that's kind of an asset, and it sort of is. But this is 100% asset backed. Fast, scalable settlement rails, which is a mechanism of actually exchanging value. By the way, Bitcoin doesn't have fast, scalable settlement rails, and nobody wants to find out that they bought a pizza that's now worth $75 million with a few pieces of Bitcoin later on. So the problem with this is why you need a stable coin, is stable coins don't appreciate in value. In fact, by design, they stay stable. And you need this because if you own something that's likely to go up in value, you are tempted not to spend it. And so that, remember our example of passing the five peso note around? You want people to not want to hold on to it. You want people to spend it. So you want it to be stable so they don't have any reason not to spend it. You want it to move through the economy. In fact, ideally, you want it to be depreciating slightly in value, which is why the Philippine government prints more pesos every year to devalue the peso so that you won't hold on to it because there's no benefit to holding on to it. The angels are singing. Okay, this token, this coin will be backed by significant liquidity. This is a real problem in the crypto space today. And the dirty little secret is that it's really easy to buy Bitcoin, it's very difficult to sell it. There's multiple reasons for this. One is that it's not KYC AML compliant, so banks don't want to touch it because they don't want to lose their license. So that's one of the reasons. The other reason is there's not very much liquidity in the market. With all this trading going on, most of it is between crypto and crypto. It's not between crypto and fiat. So in our economic model, we actually have 20% of our token supply backed by fiat at any given time as a minimum. This means on any given day, 20% of all of the Bridgecoin holders on Earth could sell all of their coin and go out to fiat on that day, and it wouldn't affect the price at all. A lot of the ups and downs in Bitcoin occur as a result of people needing to liquidate it for various reasons, and if that happens with a bunch of people needing to liquidate it at the same time, it brings down the price tremendously because there really isn't that much liquidity in the market. Liquidity is just other people that will exchange cash for Bitcoin. There's just not a lot of people that will want to do that in any depth. So this mechanism combined with this one, Sweetcoin. Now Sweetcoin is a discount token. A discount token is a very special kind of token. It provides users with discounts on fees. So how many people here buy Starbucks? You see some Starbucks. Okay. There's some people that buy Starbucks. Okay, we got one hand, two hands. I know you have Starbucks. Okay, that's right. You know what those guys look like. So imagine Starbucks having a discount coin. And you can buy a Starbucks discount coin, and then every month you go into Starbucks, and let's say you have 10 Starbucks discount coins, and you get $1 a month off per coin that you own. So you go into Starbucks, and the first $10 of product you buy from Starbucks every month is free. Guess where you buy your coffee? Starbucks. Why? Well, because my first 10 cups are free. My first $10 are free. So I buy it from Starbucks. So what this does is this creates recurring customers. What do you tell your friends when you go to Starbucks? Oh, let me get that for you. Why? Because it's free. It's free, right? So what do your friends start doing? Well, they start going to Starbucks. When you need to meet somebody, and you're going to meet someplace, where do you say to meet? Oh, hey, let's meet at Starbucks. Why? Because you know you get that free cup of coffee where you're there. Doesn't cost you anything. But if you go to Post Coffee, you're going to pay money. So this creates customer loyalty. This creates customer reoccurring use. And so this is getting the customer to have a value. So you see the principles from before coming into this here. This is exactly how we're doing it. So as the discount grows as the network grows. So because the number of coins are restricted in count, and because the coin supply is like Bitcoin, it only releases as the network grows. So coins are released over time in a gradual fashion. What happens is that the discount value of the coin grows as the total revenue on the platform grows. So as there's more customers, the discount value goes up. Now think of this in our Starbucks example. So you started out, you bought that Starbucks coin, you got those 10 coins, and now you're using them every month, and you got a dollar off for each coin, so you get 10 bucks free. Now Starbucks starts growing. There's more Starbucks out there, and so what happens now is that coin goes up to the point where it's worth $10 a coin per month in discount value. So now you get $100 of Starbucks every month for free. Now, you don't drink that much Starbucks. Okay, let's say you just don't, you know, your doctor told you to hold off on the coffee. And you don't really care for their food or other things, so you don't drink that much coffee. You have more Starbucks purchasing power now than you need. What do you do with it? Well, you sell some of it. You sell it to who? When you sell it to somebody else, guess what they become? A Starbucks customer. So as the network grows and you get to a point where you don't need all the discount power, the owners of the token are incentivized to find other customers for Starbucks, which brings more people into the network, which grows the network, which brings more people into the network, which grows the network, which brings more people into the network, and which grows the network. This is the power of good token design. You create a mechanism where as your customers use you, you increase the value back to the customer, which causes the customers to want to use you, which increases the number of customers, which causes the customers to want to use you, which increases the numbers of customers. Yes?
Very simple question. The customer is going to lay money in the store.
Yeah.
The guy that comes and steals free coffee. Because that's what they're promoting here.
It is not. I know why you say that. I'll explain why. If what you do is you basically just give people products for free, that would be true. But you didn't. You see, you sold them a token, and what did you use that token for? You used that token for the same thing you would have sold your stock for, or you would have bought loans for, all of which would have cost you money in future revenue. Taking a percentage of your money in future revenue. What you're doing is trading the mechanism of funding being debt or equity to a mechanism of funding being pulling revenue from the future from your customers into the present, using that as the mechanism to fund your business. And so I didn't put slides in here, but I actually have slides. We have a great white paper that explains all this in detail. If you want to download it, and it will show you exactly how that doesn't actually, you know, have people rob you of money, but it actually does the reverse. It actually puts more money in your pocket. Business model using token economics. So I want you to pick something that is of interest to you around your table, something that's already somebody's already got an idea about, something that you're already doing, something that you would want to do, something you learned from the day. Take something and put together an idea for a business using token economics based on what we've talked about. We're going to give you 15 minutes. I'm going to set my iPhone timer. When it goes off, we're going to then have somebody from each table who kind of shares their idea of what they came up with, and then we'll kind of see where we go from there. Okay? So Sure. The question is, what is token economics? So it's token economics is about designing a business model. The business model is just the way the business makes money and operates, which makes money by... That makes money by having a token which appreciates in value. Makes money by having a token that appreciates in value. And you're going to have a token appreciate in value by having it limited in supply and having a reason for customers to use it. And if you need help, you can start with the example I gave of a discount token. And if you want to add more than one token, a plus credit to you, because any system that's going to really grow and be sustainable will need a dual token design. You're going to find that's going to be very common in the future. But don't need to do that either. Just come up with what your idea is. Pick something that you think about, something you've been talking about, or whatever, and then in 15 minutes, I'll have each table kind of share their idea. Any other questions? All right. Here we go. My wife has to hold one. talk to everybody. So take it away, introduce yourselves, and tell us about your ideas.
Hi, I'm Nick Sherwin. I used to work for a company called Trax Technologies. I worked for a guy named Scott Nelson for 11 years. I was the regional operations director there for, you know, the last time. I kind of semi-retired, and this guy gave me the capital to start my own business. I'm into now to a very different, coming from IT, I'm into pigs and coconuts. So let me tell you about how, for me, this is very real.
I was meant to introduce myself after your ideas. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Cal Bui. I am a business administration student from the University of San Carlos. I can't believe I'm the only one from my school here today. Anyways, I don't really have a classy introduction or something as long experience as my compatriot here, but I used to work as an LRO when going to school, labor relations officer. Apart from that, that's basically all I got.
Right, thank you. We go back to a quick overview on, depends on what you want to start with. You want to start with coconuts or pigs? Let's start with coconuts. True enough, this is a very different area from where I used to work for. I started from scratch. I, you know, dive in the ins and outs of, you know, everything, where to get a supply, how to get a coconut, where to sell it. And I realized, listening to Scott about blockchain, how real this applies to my business right now. Who here knows how much you can buy one coconut in the province? Like, rough guess, in pesos. Alright. General market knowledge is 5 pesos, but if you are a shrewd businessman like me, you can get it at 3 pesos. Each coconut. Who knows here how much that coconut sells in the city?
35.
Good guess. It's 30 pesos. So, what is the markup there from 3 to 30? And that's the amazing part. So when I went into this business, I'm lucky to know to have found a guy who was like a 10 hectare property, sells me coconuts for 3 pesos each. Then I paid a couple of guys 2 pesos each just to get the coconut from the tree. 2 pesos each. Logistics wise, if I divide it per trip, it costs me about 1 peso and 60 cents to transport that coconut here. And it depends on what coconut product that they use, or sell it raw, or convert it to coconut juice, or any coconut-based product. So I have roughly about, my cost is about 7 pesos and 60 cents. And it sells here for 30 pesos. Where is the gap there? So a gap from 760 to 30, that's where, you know, the whole concept of supply chain distribution comes in. In the coconut business, money is power, liquidity is power. What Scott was telling about blockchain, I kind of felt bad because, I mean, I kind of learned to be a shrewd businessman, and, you know, we buyers of coconut products dictate the price. The guy that I buy the coconuts, he owns a 10 hectare lot, but if you go and check his house, still poor. Why is that? The reason why is this guy does not have access to the further down the supply chain, and, you know, he needs money. We dictate the price of how much we buy from you. If we don't, we say, okay, you want to sell it for me for 3 pesos or not? I'll buy from the other guy. And you say yes. Right? So So imagine there, and you know, logistics, distribution, retail. I finally found, you know, a way to cut the supply chain, you know, to own the supply chain from point A to point Z. But that's me. That's me being a shrewd businessman. That's me having, you know, just enough capital to play the game. But what about this guy that I pay, this group of five people that I pay, that spends 2 days to get about 1,000 coconuts per order? They're still, you know, forgive me for the description, but they're still poor. And they've been doing this for all their lives. They don't have any access or transparency at all on what potential there could be down the line. They don't. Even the supplier of the coconut products, he doesn't have a clue how much power, how much he can earn, you know, if he has some access to this. And they never attempted to access, it's very hard for them to access capital for business. They go to a bank. I would doubt it if the bank would hardly lend them any money to, you know, just put up their own business, you know, put in a distribution center, you know. But if you sell coconuts as is, we don't change anything in the coconut. It's just a coconut. It's sell as is. We don't inject water. We don't inject sugar. But what we have as businessmen is just the power to make big price. Before Scott was here and the rest of you, I was like, me and my colleague and my wife were always saying, we kind of feel bad because like a lot of businessmen in this business takes advantage of the word called ignorance. Yes, ignorance could be a lack of access to capital. Could be, you know, they're just not that liquid. They have assets, they have this 10 hectare land, but they just don't have any money. And that's why they depend on me to say, I'm going to buy all of those coconuts that you have for this harvest at this price because they need the money. And I kind of feel bad for them. And I think if we kind of employ this model, there's something. It's going to become very real for them. It's going to level out the playing field. And it's going to pay, I think it's transformational. I know I'm saying the quiet guy of the business kind, but this is also a learning opportunity for me. Even for my pig farm, it's the same. I buy small piglets, I grow it. After 2 to 3 months, I sell it per kilo. Do you know that there's a different price if you sell it live? And if you kill the pig, there's also a different price. But if you have your own meat shop, the price just skyrockets. If you put the salad live for today in a town called Barili, south of Cebu, a live pig costs about 120 pesos per kilo. If you kill it, it's about 20 pesos more, it's 140. But if you look at and buy meat, pork in the wet market, it's about 220, 240. A big jump from the actual cost. And that's where the whole supply concept, you know, all the supply chain layers comes in. The middleman that controls, you know, insurance with me at the time. And so,
I won't take too long now. All right, I was thinking about how to apply these blockchain models to different business industries for the benefit of the entire market. And the very first thing that came into my mind was the education industry in this country. I chose the education industry because first and foremost, I'm talking about private education, by the way. This country has a technology problem. Most of the individuals are barely connected to the internet. So there exists already a problem on how to utilize the technology in the first place because we don't have the means to do so. No? Now, with the current schools that we have, there's a problem securing a stable clientele for each private school. Schools have very high transfer rates amongst each other in this country. So what I had in mind was applying Mr.
For the business idea that I'm proposing, this is going to be called Power Token and Boost Token. In a nutshell, Power Token will be used for paying your utilities, paying for your Vetco, paying for your water bills, paying for your credit card, paying for all the utilities that you're going to be needing to pay. You can also use this to pay for your insurance, but the catch is it's not going to fluctuate. Why? Because by using Power Tokens, you're going to be receiving a reward for it, which is going to be the Boost Token. What is going to be the Boost Token and the Power Token? This still will work as the fiat currency in the Philippines, perhaps. And this is going to be used for people to negotiate for goods and services to be paid. What I mean to say is, if you're going to use Power Token, you're going to be receiving Boost Token to pay for goods and services. You're going to use your Power Token to, in exchange of the Philippine Peso, and in return of using the Power Token, you're also going to be receiving Boost Token for free. Meaning, you shell out 100, you're going to be receiving 50. And the reason is because we need the market to keep, we need the currency to keep running. So, you shell out 100, receive 50, all in all, you're going to be receiving 150. Alright, so, there are current cryptocurrencies that are already using it and platforms here in the Philippines, such as coins.ph. But the thing in coins.ph, you're going to be needing an internet. You're going to be needing the application to use it. You're going to be needing membership. If you're going to be having Power Tokens, you don't need membership. All you need to do is to shell out an amount, Power Token, and you're going to be receiving the Boost Token once you make the payment. You just need receipt. That's it.
Now that we're cutting on to a very large industry, by the way, you've got some great ideas there. You ought to check out there's some fabulous work being done on power in Africa. By the way, you might want to look at some of the projects there. Power is going to be a really interesting thing. There's some really exciting stuff that you can do in localized power grids, neighborhood power grids. It's an amazing up and coming area. There's some really neat stuff being done in Africa, and it's being tokenized in that space. Who's next? All right.
Maybe I'm going to divide my money, so I'm going to search
for some places like in the city, and I'm going to buy a portion of land, and then I'm going to build a house or apartment. Then, so what I'm saying is, I love to have active and passive income. So you're having a secret investment.
And to summarize, we talked about the government giving a big print bond. So the bond is in the form of Bitcoin. The other idea we had was to really decentralize or get rid of the gatekeepers and intermediaries. Every single human being has their own ICO. So every person here has got gel coin, rubber coin, cross coin, everyone's got their own ICO. And they trade with each other like bartering, but a crypto version of bartering. So they approach each other and they barter with each other. Okay, I'll give you some. My coin is worth 5 of your coins, is worth 1 of my coin, then we'll go barter. The ledger, the digital ledger, actually keeps track of all the coins that you traded with, your coins, with whoever, and it's kind of a way of making the trade more market orientated. So there's no gatekeepers at all issuing ICOs. Everyone has their own. The government issues everyone. So the moment they're born, they're issued with their own ICO.
One thing is, I think the best way to improve is that the government should have programs of investments like the stocks, bonds, options, and Bitcoin. Because most of the Filipinos are close-minded, because when you say Bitcoin, it's so risky. But they're not thinking about the return also. They're just thinking about the risk and the loss.
Exchange-traded funds. There is some great work that's being done on that. A whole bunch of projects working on ETFs, by the way. A bunch out of London, a bunch out of New York. Look them up. ETF. It's known as ETF, Joe. ETFs, exchange-traded funds on blockchains. It's a great idea. The tokenization of people. Rob's idea. There's been a bunch of interesting work on that, by the way, out of Sweden. You might want to look into that if you want to do that. There are both pros and cons to that idea. Some people say it would create a race to the bottom. It's kind of the same problem of maybe having a gig economy for everything we do. And other people say it's the way to basically allow people to finance their future earning power. So. It's a very interesting area of debate. Who's next? All right, come on, Will. Will and John. All right. All right, so what do you guys got?
All right, so good afternoon. The coins here are US dollars, so you can just go to add that directly. Another thing is when you use our online coins, and you actually let's say you exchange rate, you exchange $500 for 500 Noman coins, or would also try to put an incentive, let's say exchange $500 for Noman coins. One of our partners, you're gonna get a free zipline ride, you're gonna get a free something like that, just to get people to actually try to use more of our coins. And it's a good way to save money when you're traveling. Now, Noman coins is applied, you can apply it in the Philippines, but it can also be a white label to sit down specific areas in the future, from Bahamas or to Japan or to wherever. So it can just make different coins for different areas. So that's one of our ideas, and yeah.
All right, you guys might want to look up local, what are known as LETS, L-E-T-S. LETS are local exchange. systems. There's actually some running in the United States, one in Vermont that's been operating for a very long time. There's one in Sao Paulo, Brazil, which is the largest in the world, which does exactly what you're talking about. You can learn a lot from the examples. There's also this idea of a business that's been around for 70 years doing the same thing in Switzerland called the WIR Bank, W-I-R. And for every Swiss franc out there, they add another 20 cents to it in WIR, that's what they called it, tokens. And it's 70 years old. Okay, we'll take our last group. All right. We got the last two. All right. We'll take two more. All right. Come on up. All right. Give us your names and tell us about yourself.
Sir, I have a question for you. Yes. What was the subject of the exercise again?
Token economics. How do you build a business model using token economics?
We have created the white paper already. One of our business partners is coming from, I forgot, his name is Puya. He's going to work as an integrator for the MindsChat project. Basically, our platform is about tokenizing remittances. Philippines is one of the top three countries who export people who are going to register for W. And remittances in the Philippines is really high, that creating this platform would enable families to connect, because our platform has a chat in it where both members of the family could see the balances and could say thank you right away after sending the money. So it's basically a tokenized remittances. And we already finished the white paper, so anybody who is willing to see the white paper, it's already on the web. I mean, on Google Docs, and you can see it in a time. And Jackie, you have nothing to say. Basically, it's a free. Sorry,
yeah, you can read your notes.
So basically, it's a free token remittance app that is a direct transaction from an OFW to his or her family to the Philippines. It is a wallet in which it can also be a wallet or an account where if the family to the Philippines ask for money with his family from abroad, he can just chat him using this minus chat. So the family can see the balance on the right corner, and then they can just talk to through the chat. And that's it. So they can say thank you right away, right there in the platform, without going to Simona or Palawan right there, especially in the mountain. They can just do it right away. Thank you, sir.
All right, global remittance, that is big business, very big business. We got a group in the back here, though. All right, so we'll do one more after this, all right.
As an incentivization to get people to get onto the platform, to start contributing to the platform, allow even the users of the platform to incentivize each other to recommend their products or whatever. So, in a way, this changes everything. You can imagine if there was a Facebook where you got paid to like somebody's pictures, Facebook would go away and this new platform would take over. So, you can imagine the opportunity. I'll pass over to John to talk about his specifics.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Sherry Nathan-Egan, a Bachelor of Science and Accountancy student from Cebu Institute of Technology. Since I feel that some people might be hungry, let's make you hungrier. So let's talk about food. So our idea was just a food that is served on us at this moment. It is Taron. To everyone who isn't familiar with Taron, it is we produce Torrons because we're inspired by the Torrons, then we want the environment to be a win-win situation. We're it, the producers of Torrons, and the customers will be happy at the end of the day. So how does this happen? We will advertise the Torron through the customers. Like, for example, for every percentage of purchase of these Torrons, for example, 5,000 pieces of Torrons. It gives us the variety of choices, the free will that the company and the company and its clients will be very happy at the end of the day. So that's it. Thank you.
In Japan, and the business is all about disrupting farming industry. But first, there are several problems in Japanese farming industry. First one is just a centralized organization called Agricultural Cooperative. And most farmers in Japan, there are 240,000 farmers. And most of them are relying on that agricultural cooperation. So also, just another problem is the aging society. Compared with Philippines, the average age of Japan is very high, and especially farmers, most of them are already more than 65 years old. So they are going to retire soon. So in the future, what will happen is the farming land will be abandoned because the farmers will not work on that anymore. So I like to solve that problem. To solve that problem, there are two ways to do that. One thing is giving more land to CIS farmers. So good farmers will gain more land and they will cultivate more food. There will be no problem. And another option is for giving more land. There should be another way of gaining fund. Currently, farmers are relying on that organization, centralized organization. So only way to gaining fund is to go there. And if they say no, you cannot gain no fund. So to solve that problem, I plan to start from making some marketplace. That marketplace is for buying, people can buy food from the farmer's directory. So if the farmer is cultivating good food, good vegetable, they can gain more, better reputations. And gradually, you can see which farmer is cultivating good food. And after that, if the farmer wants to buy more land, or for example, if they want to buy drone to spread more medicine, in that case, they can there's a fund in that market, in that place. So buyers like me, I will invest you for buying new land. And the farmer will buy new land with that investment, and they will cultivate more food or vegetable. And if they gain profit, they can distribute that profit to the investors. So it will if we make the, I mean both buyers like you and farmers gain profit from cultivating more good food. So I think it is better for Japan because currently centralized organization is doing everything.
So thank you so much for coming out.